Welcome to Park Place Views. I'm your host, Rachel Nabors, Management Information Intern in the City Manager's Office. Thank you for joining us today. Park Place Views is a monthly program where we take a look at what's going on in your city government, the city of Janesville, Wisconsin's Park Place. If you missed last month's episode, we spoke with the city's Director of Public Works, Paul Woodard, as well as the city's Planning Services Manager, Dwayne Cherick, to learn about all what's happening in downtown Janesville. You can find previous episodes of Park Place Views on the city's website and JATV's YouTube channel. Today, we will be sitting down with the Fire Chief, Randy Banker, to learn about some exciting things happening in the Janesville Fire Department. I am joined now by Chief Banker. Welcome and thanks for being with us today. Randy Banker was appointed to the position of Fire Chief on January 5, 2016. He is originally from Edgerton, but began his career in the fire service with the Geneva, Illinois Fire Department in 1984. In 1988, he was hired by the Batavia, Illinois Fire Department, where he climbed the ranks to become Deputy Fire Chief. Randy holds a bachelor's degree in fire science from Columbia Southern University in Orange Beach, Alabama. He also holds several fire and emergency medical certifications. Thanks for being here and giving our viewers the opportunity to learn more about the Janesville Fire Department. Before we get started, can you tell us a little bit more about yourself? What made you want to work in public safety at the beginning of your career, Chief?
Well, first of all, it's hard to believe I've been here over a year already. It's been a fast year, but my career started when I was young. I was in high school and I was playing baseball, and my high school coach was a volunteer firefighter on the Geneva Fire Department at that time, and I was going to play some baseball in college, and he threw out the idea of joining the fire department. So I got on the Geneva Fire Department in 1984, and truly the moment I walked in the fire station, I fell in love. And it's a passion, and it's a career that I'm glad I've gotten into, and it's taken me a long way. So back in high school is when it started, and I just really, really enjoyed it. I love every aspect of it, so.
And now you're here.
Now we ended up here, yeah.
So Chief, a lot has been happening in the JFD since the opening of the Central Fire Station this past summer, and we'll get to that, but I want to ask you, what's going on for the fire personnel at the new Central Fire Station, Chief?
Well, first of all, it took us a while just to get used to having all the space that we have in the new fire station. If you remember, the old station is, it was very small, it was not very healthy, it was dirty, had poor ventilation systems, poor heat systems, and so the fact that we just have space now for offices so people, you know, can do their jobs. And the old fire station, we had five of us in one work spot, and so just to have your own workspace, and it's comfortable, it's clean, and it gives our firefighters and paramedics an ability to, you know, when they're there for 24 hours, sometimes 24 hours can be a long shift, and sometimes it gives them an opportunity to just relax and have a meal and do their training and read and study and whatever they need to do. So just trying to get used to it has been part of it for the first couple months of it. Now we're settling in, you know, we're finding, getting all our stuff stored and shelves putting up and various other things so we can operate out of it daily and just getting used to all the stuff we have there. So it's great. Some of the other things that's a real benefit to the community too that we got with the new fire station is the ability to put all our reserve equipment at one place. And before, prior to that, at the old station, our reserve fire trucks or ambulances and various other things were spread out throughout the community. So if we have, which we have on a regular basis, where we get very busy and we have to call people back in, they used to have to run all over different parts of town to grab spare ambulance or a spare fire truck or whatever. Now everything's basically downtown. And actually, the first day we were there, opened up, it came into play huge. We had a house fire, and we had an automobile accident, and a hazardous materials event. And everybody, we called our back our off-duty staff, and they came down to the station, and then they ended up picking up a couple more calls. So it's paid for itself greatly just having all that equipment in one spot. So we're getting used to that also. So,
that's great. That's
yeah, there's
great.
A lot of great things about it, but it's working out very well, and we're just very thankful to the city itself and the community for, you know, backing us and getting the fire station.
Sounds good. Chief, I understand the JFD was recently awarded the Career Notable Award for the Central Fire Station. Can you tell us a little bit more about this award?
Yeah, the Wisconsin Association of Builders and Contractors awarded us the Notable Award for the Fire Station, a Silver Award. I believe it was submitted by Gilbank Construction, who was the contractors for the project. And then they have a statewide judging committee that judges the facility on a whole host of things, but some of them, the difficulty of the project, the cost of the project, the type of project, any type of uniqueness that is about the project itself. And we ended up winning it. And as a matter of fact, a week ago, last Thursday, we were invited up to Wisconsin Dells for the presentation, and we had a dinner, and they presented us the award, and it was a great honor. And the critical thing, too, is there's a national magazine, Fire Chief Magazine, and we were also recognized in that magazine with roughly about 20, 25 other fire departments across the country. And one of the things that was most notable, besides the design and the efficiency of the building, is our cost per square foot was second from the bottom. We were $188 per square feet. There was fire stations that were $600-$700 a square feet. So not only is our building efficient and effective, and it looks very nice, it was cost effective. And you know, the team we had within the city of Janesville, from the building department, engineering department, and Deputy Chief Bonkoskis from the fire department, you know, they did a phenomenal job on making sure the price stayed down and was cost effective, and it's an efficient fire station. So it's a double bonus for our community on that.
Well, congratulations to the JFD for winning that award. Chief, I keep hearing about how much busier the fire department is over past years. In 2016, what were your calls for service versus in previous years?
Yeah, last year we projected we were going to get for 2016 about 10,000 calls, and we just fell shy of that. And that's a good thing. You know, we don't want to be busy, but we are, unfortunately. And we were about 9,839 calls for 2016. That's up a couple hundred calls from 2015. Mm-hmm. The call volume is increasing every day. The community, part of that is from the community is growing. There's some economic development going on in the community, which is a great thing. So the community is growing. There's homes being built. There's new businesses being built. So that's attracting more people. So yeah, unfortunately, our calls did increase. Yeah. And that's something we as a fire department and the city are working on, and how to handle that and manage it, and we'll figure that out as we go down the road. But yeah, so it's been much busier.
What do you think is contributing to that increase?
Well, there's a host of things, in my opinion. There's, like I just said, the community's growing. There's a lot of activity going on, which is excellent. The other thing that happens is we're you know, with the interstate, we have a lot of commuter traffic. The interstate has a lot of traffic, from truck traffic to travelers, you know, tourists, business traffic. So the traffic on the interstate is increasing regularly. That's an impact. The other one is when you look at the county itself, not just Janesville, but the county itself, in a recent health assessment of the county, is unfortunately Rock County is not a very healthy community. And we have some issues with significant issues in the community with obesity, smoking. We have some issues with trips and falls, people falling. We exceed the national and state levels there. So just obesity and smoking are huge contributing factors to other medical issues. So we have a high number of that. So that contributes to it. I'm sure everybody has been seeing on the news, national news and the local news, we have an unfortunate issue with the opioid problem or the heroin issue. So we're trying to address that and how we can do that, which is a sad event. But just this morning I was doing some more research and looking at some other options, how we can be far more proactive as a fire department, as a community, to reach out into that, to the community, and help people who have those issues. So we're working on that too. And then the other thing is the fire department just does more now. And one of the things we do too, which is a great service to the region, to Janesville and the region, is we also provide transfers from our local hospital, St. Mary's and Mercy, for specific critical type of events to other medical centers. Sometimes people, when they have certain types of medical events or automobile accidents or pediatric emergencies or, and in some cases, some severe psychological issues, they need to get to another facility. Sometimes they can't be flown by a helicopter, and sometimes some of the private ambulances are unavailable and can't do it. And the hospitals have reached out to us in the past years to work with them, to partner with them, to try to get a transfer program to get people to critical care facilities as quick as we can. So we've been doing that, and that's been very successful, and it really does help helps the region and the city itself. So we're happy to be doing that.
That's great. A really exciting and recent development is the discussion about shared services with the Milton Fire Department. What specific services will actually be shared with Milton, Chief?
Actually, we've already started some of that. The official intergovernmental agreement was signed and put in place February 1st. Excuse me. But we started end of last year, we started with called shared services on enhanced responses. Okay. So there's parts of our community at the very north end, and so at the very north end of Janesville, that it would be helpful if Milton would help us. So we have them coming on certain calls up on the north end. We also go to Milton on certain types of calls in various parts of their community. But the other thing we did is we enhanced for Janesville for when we have building fires or structure fires. We have them coming automatically to assist us, to supplement our staffing so we can meet. There's some unfunded federal mandates that we're required to meet from staffing and different types of things like that. So they help us meet those standards, plus it makes sure we have enough people at the incident and we're not getting our people beat up too bad or exhausted. So they're helping us from a fire standpoint. They help us on when we get real busy with ambulances, which happens on a regular basis. So we'll call them for assistance sometimes for ambulance or just fill in and make sure other calls are covered. We'll help them with fires. We'll help them with severe ambulance calls because Milton does not have paramedics. Mm-hmm. So we assist them with paramedics. We'll send an ambulance up and assist them if they need. So right now it's been shared enhanced responses, which is a great benefit to both communities and the region. And then there's some potential things we may do in the future. We may look at some shared services and administrative services from fire prevention to office administration, those type of things. We may even look at further some other stuff from you know, the chief level. Are we going to look at some combined or shared services there? And then the other exciting part is we do need a fire station at the very northeast end of town, and Milton needs a new fire station. So we're even looking at the possibility of building a joint fire station between the two communities. So that would be a benefit for both of us from a financial standpoint and from an effective response area. So we're really looking forward to that, and we're, you know, it's a great foundation where we're at, and it can only build from here. And with the way things are in the state with some levy limits and certain other things, it's hard to grow your different departments within your city. So this is a great foundation for us to grow and share services and provide maybe even a little better care, but at the same cost if we can. So we're looking forward to it.
Thanks, Chief. When will these changes specifically go into effect, do you know?
Right. Well, like I said, the response ones have already taken effect and are working out really well, been very beneficial. We meet regularly with their administration, myself and their administration. And right now we're in a development stage of how we want to proceed, which way we want to go, and how fast we want to go. And a lot of that is up to Milton, okay. You know. So we're letting them sort of take the lead because they had the thing that sort of helped them trigger them moving forward in this is their fire chief retired last year. Oh. So they are right now with an interim chief. And so if things are going to move forward, it's sort of a good time to do it because nobody's going to be fired, nobody's going to be laid off. It isn't intended to eliminate jobs or anything like that. It's just trying to be more efficient. So some stuff will start playing out here throughout the 2017 year. So,
how will you say this will affect Janesville residents when they call 911 for EMS services?
Well, it enhances our services, and one of the things that we are dealing with right now, and we're trying to correct the problem, is we only have four paramedic ambulance staffed 24 hours a day.
Okay.
We have a fifth ambulance at the west side on Station 3, which is on the west side of Janesville. We're trying to fill that when we're at our adequate staffing levels and we have the people there, we staff it on a basically on a part-time basis. Our goal is try to get that staffed more often, and we're trying to, our ultimate goal is to get it staffed 100% of the time. So until then, we only have four ambulances, and unfortunately, we go through four ambulances sometimes on a daily basis. So there's times we'll call Milton for an ambulance, we'll call them for a fire engine. So they're enhancing our response and our service, and so that's a huge thing for us as a community, so to have that partnership with another community.
That's great. Do you see any other consolidation efforts on the horizon anytime soon?
You know, it's obviously in Wisconsin here, there's some other communities that have done it and are moving that way. I think we're probably the first couple cities here in the maybe south central Wisconsin or southern Wisconsin that have done it. It's drawn attention from other people across the state, and some people may be watching us to see how it plays out. I'm sure there's always potentials down the road of other communities or other fire departments wanting to get together. They may not be with us, maybe they'll consolidate or join up or shared service with other fire departments. But yeah, I think we're gonna sort of set the tone.
Nice. So moving on, Chief, I recall that you recently received a grant from the Janesville Foundation to purchase new tactical gear. Can you tell me more about that grant and what gear has been purchased?
Yeah, unfortunately, within the fire service, we're having to do things that I never thought we would do in my 32 years of service. We now have situations throughout the country that we have to deal with as active shooter type of events. Mm-hmm. And so the nice part about us is we're taking a proactive step in that, and we do what's called, we have been training with our local law enforcement, mainly the Janesville Police Department. It's called Rescue Task Forces. And it's unfortunately, when you have these horrific events, the problem is that sometimes you have a lot of people injured. And so what they're finding is the best thing for survivability of these people is get them out of there as quick as you can. And that's the concept of the Rescue Task Forces. How can fire be integrated with the police, the law enforcement, but can get in there safely and effectively get the injured people out and get them to care as quick as we can. So that's the Rescue Task Force side of it. And then we have what's called TEMS, which is Tactical EMS, which we now have some people trained in who are gonna be embedded it with the law enforcement when they go into these events, and they can give three or four different disciplines of life-saving events to these people, and then they get evacuated from the school or the building or whatever it is. But to do that, we had to have the equipment. We can't have our people being in an area where there's possibly shots being fired and not having protective equipment. So we put together a list of equipment, tactical equipment, ballistic equipment for all firefighters that are on duty. But we didn't have the money for it, and we had not budgeted for it. So we applied for a grant for $29,000, roughly $30,000. And we were fortunate enough to get it. So we've now dressed out the whole, all on-duty personnel can have the tactical protection, and it did not cost the city a penny. So we're moving forward in that training. And actually, we had some training yesterday with the SWAT, Janesville SWAT. So it's been really unfortunate we have to do it, but at least we're proactive and we're moving in a positive direction, and hopefully we'll never have to use it.
Sounds good. I hear the JFD acquired some new equipment in 2016. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah. Unfortunately, many years past, with certain types of purchasing, the Janesville Fire Department purchased a lot of equipment at one time. So unfortunately, when you buy a lot of equipment at one time, it gets old and beat up at one time. So in the last, prior to me coming here, and then last year, and even in 2017, we're trying to stagger out some of those purchases, trying to stagger out some of the expense. And so in 2016, we were fortunate enough to get two new fire engines and two new ambulances. So we're very fortunate, and we're very thankful from the city council and the city manager's office and the community to support us in trying to get that equipment, because it was in dire straits. And we still have a fire truck now that the company is bankrupt and out of business, and we can't even get equipment, parts for it. So we're not out of the woods completely, but we're working on it. We're in a much better shape than we were just a year ago. So we got the two new ambulances and two new engines, and they're in service and working, so.
Cool. The JFD also received another grant from the state of Wisconsin for improved EMS equipment. What kind of equipment is this? And what will be the benefit to the Janesville residents?
Well, again, you know, our biggest area of increase in calls is EMS, all types of medical calls, cardiacs, you know, asthma attacks, various types of EMS. And what we did as effective of January 1st of this year is we put on all our fire engines and our ladder truck downtown a host of medical supplies, certain medical drugs for cardiac events, you know, just a it's not a complete ambulance package of EMS equipment, but it's an abbreviated package of equipment from medical supplies and certain types of drugs, and then each of the vehicles also have an AED. So they're not, we also have paramedics on each of our vehicles. So what's happens is it gives us the ability, is you'll see a lot of times a fire engine going because there's times we don't have an ambulance close, we'll send a fire engine and the fire engine will be there first. Well, we wanted them to be able to give care. We didn't want them to wait till the ambulance got there to give them care. So now the paramedics on that engine can start paramedic care as they wait for the ambulance to get there. So that, to me, didn't really cost us a penny, but we're truly gonna see lives saved with those, with that equipment, and then the amazing paramedics that we have on the fire truck. So that's gonna be a huge benefit to the community.
That's good. Do you see the horizon? What do you see on the horizon in terms of changes for the future of the JFD?
Well, you know, one of the things that I talk to my department regularly since I've been here, and you know, obviously a new chief came in from the outside, but the department has been amazing to me. The city has been amazing to me. The community has really accepted me, and I'm very thankful for that. So I'm very lucky. But for changes, I don't even talk about changes anymore. What I talk about is progress. Every fire department just needs to be progressive and not look at everything the same way or the way we've always done it just because we did. So one of the things I keep pushing from a cultural standpoint is we have to be progressive. We have to look at every aspect of the department and are we moving forward, or are we, is there things that are no good anymore and we should get rid of them, you know? And so we're looking at all those things. So just from a culture standpoint and progress, the Janesville Fire Department's working on that stuff every day, and we're excited about that. Some of the things for us in a term of progress, what I look at is I try to plan down the road. I don't look for today or tomorrow or next year. I try to look for 5 years, 10 years down the road. And presently right now we're in the process of looking at two additional fire stations, the one on the north side with Milton. And then we're also in the process of working on developing and trying to locate a place on the south side of town, possibly nearer in the airport, because we need some protection down there. So just from a growth of a department, we are gonna probably end up growing in years to come. We gotta figure out how to get there financially, but we'll figure something out. We have some great partners with other communities, some local businesses. City Hall is, you know, the city manager, and the council has been very open. And that's partially, I think, one of the reasons I was brought here is to, you know, we gotta start looking and progressing down the road. So that's what we're trying to do. And I'm trying to do it as the least cost that we can. So that's my goal.
Cool. Chief, many people believe firefighters' only duty is to put out fires and provide paramedic services. Even though some of those are very important services, what other services do you provide to the community?
Well, those two are critical,
yeah.
And we do those every day. I think we're at 29 calls a day now. And so those two are very critical. But what we do, other things that we do on a regular basis is just community relations. Our people are in the community every day doing calls, assisting people at the worst time of their life sometimes. It could be, you know, a life-threatening medical event or a fire or an automobile accident. So our community, our fire department's always trying to, you know, be out there to support the community, not just sitting around waiting for calls. We do fire prevention. We're required, one of the things a lot of people don't realize is, for example, when you have Dollar General comes into the city of Janesville, the zoning and building department, they're a part of that development. The fire department and fire prevention is a part of that development and building of that building. But the one thing that people don't realize is once the building's up, occupancy is made, and the building moves on, the building department and the code enforcement, they sort of are step aside, they're done. fire department, we basically have to do our business with that building for the life of that building. So we have to do inspections. We have to do any type of life safety issues with that building for the life of that building. So we have a fire prevention bureau, which has to do roughly, 5,100 or so inspections every year of all these buildings in town. And then we have to enforce all those type of things. Unfortunately, that's not, some people in the community don't like that. We understand that, but we're just enforcing the codes and the laws that are set forth by the state of Wisconsin and, you know, the city of Janesville.
Doing
so we do, doing our job, you know, trying to do it the best we can. So we do, we're doing that every day. Fire investigations, you know, unfortunately a week or 2 weeks ago we had a sad event with a fire with a fatality in it. So we have to investigate that. We work side by side with law enforcement on that, and our fires last year were up. Our fires were up significantly last year. So, and it's state statute, state law requires us, we have to investigate fires. So it doesn't have to be a big building fire to have us investigated. Even car fires we have to investigate. So fire investigations, we have a great program for child seats, car safety seats. We have Lieutenant Kesnick does a phenomenal job with that, and it's I think it's the first Wednesday of the month at Station 5, or dates vary, but it's, you can always look it up on the website. But it's how to certified car seat installers, where they can help people put their car seats in their car. I find this interesting because my sons, we had car seats, but it was nothing like it is now. But you know, we're helping the community a lot with this, because we get a lot of grandparents that come in that don't know how to get their car seats in their car. So it's a great program. That's all run by grants. Doesn't cost the city really any money on that. So that's a great program. We're always doing various other things, community talks, public safety events. We are also involved with the Red Cross and the Professional Firefighters of Wisconsin in a fire smoke detector installation program. And last time I checked, we were number two behind Milwaukee on free installation of these smoke detectors. The detectors are free, and then we get a great group of, you know, a bunch of our firefighters and then volunteers from the Red Cross, and then we go out amongst the community and install these smoke detectors. Actually, we'll be having one coming up here in mid to late March. Another, we're going to go out and do that. So we do those kind of things. Our big thing is prevention. We want to prevent anything. We would prefer not to have to do anything, but unfortunately that's not the case. You know, people are going to get sick, accidents are going to happen. So we try to just share with the community as best we can about life safety issues. And then there's other stuff, you know, we have to do public events and various other CPR classes and stuff like that. But so we're involved in about every aspect of the community on a daily basis.
All good things. Yeah. Lately I hear about carbon monoxide detectors as much as smoke detectors. Why are carbon monoxide detectors so important?
Well, carbon monoxide is odorless and tasteless. And it's anywhere that there's a fuel-based fire, like a furnace or, you know, those type of things. And the problem is carbon monoxide affects people differently. So the size of the person can be affected. So I'm a little bit heavier than you and bigger. So you could have a CO problem in this building. And since you're a smaller person, you may get affected by it quicker.
Wow.
Or pregnant women are affected more severely by it. Children are affected more severely. So I may not even have a problem, but maybe your kids in the house are sick or feel like they got the flu. And carbon monoxide is prevalent everywhere. And so the problem is with carbon monoxide is sometimes you don't even realize there's a problem until it's too late. So that's why we you know, you're required to have them, but we want you to have, you know, as many, you know, you should have a CO detector outside all bedroom spaces, within the, you know, near the bedrooms, and then any of the common spaces in your house and on every floor, because it is so dangerous and it can get away from you with the cold time of year when your furnace is going, and some people use different types of heaters to heat their place. Carbon monoxide can really be a dangerous situation.
Thanks for that, Chief. Let's get into some fire safety. As we turn the corner into spring, what are some important fire prevention activities that residents should be taking care of this time of year?
Well, anything from a fire safety standpoint, I don't care if it's spring, winter, or fall, whenever it is, but families should always practice and play the game with their families about, in the event of a fire, what do we do? How do we get out of the house? what's the plan going to be for the house if there's a problem in the home? And we do it at our schools. Kids do it at schools. We do fire drills and we practice. And we really want families to do that at home, whether you're in a house, an apartment building, a townhome, I don't care what it is. If you have a problem, you should practice those type of things with your family, whoever's there. How are we going to get out? Who's calling 911? Where are we going to meet when we get outside? Maybe we'll meet at the big tree out in the corner, you know, whatever. But have a plan of where you want, how you want to handle those type of things. Make sure you got smoke detectors. Make sure the batteries are up and running. Make sure you have plenty of smoke detectors. You know, new studies are saying that if you don't have enough smoke detectors, it won't wake you up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, now the recommendation is every bedroom should have a smoke detector in it, plus your hallways, plus your common spaces, because unfortunately when kids sleep, they sleep hard, and so we want to make sure they get up. So from those aspects, just make sure you have a plan. Make sure your house has got smoke detectors and CO detectors. You know, make sure your kids know how to call 911. So they do that a lot at the schools with public education. Know how to call 911. And then as spring comes about, we're fortunate this time of year, it's been very warm, but you know, it's not necessarily fire safety, but it's a life safety issue, is playing around rivers and lakes with ice. You know, we don't want kids or anybody playing on the ice or walking out on the ice, and it's been warm lately, so the ice isn't going to be very strong, so stay away from there. And then, the final one is I always tell everybody is make sure everybody's wearing your seatbelt. You know, unfortunately, we have a fair amount of accidents, but make sure everybody's in their seatbelts, make sure the kids are in their car seats, and those are probably some of the critical items.
All good advice. If someone is interested in a career in fire service, where would they start?
Well, there's a couple different ways you can start. You can go to, a vocational school and start taking classes and become certified in firefighting. Emergency medical technician, get that certification. Paramedic. The thing I tell young people is the more education you get, the better you are. There's associate's degrees, bachelor's degrees. I encourage people to get as much education as they can. But for our fire department, what we're going to be doing is towards the late summer is we're going to start a new process for new hires. And we're going to do it a little different this time. We're still working through the plan of how we're going to do it. But we're going to make it where basically if you're a young person, 19 years old, and you have a driver's license and a high school degree, you're going to be able to apply. And then we're going to give you a period of time to the time of hire that you have to get those certifications. Because what it used to be is you had to have all these certifications before you could apply. Okay. Well, we're eliminating a whole group of people, young people across wherever, the Midwest or southern Wisconsin or Illinois that can't apply because they don't have certifications. Well, we're going to try to open the door so more people can apply, and then while they're waiting to get called, they can be going to school and getting some education, so when we do call, I do have my paramedic now. So we're hoping that's going to be a successful program, but that'll be starting this fall or this summer, and we'll advertise it on the city website.
Looking forward to it. So we're just about out of time. Chief, do you have any closing thoughts for our viewers at home?
I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to sit and talk with you, and I know you're going to be done here in the spring now. Probably won't have this opportunity again, and we'll miss you, but just thank you, and if anybody needs anything from the fire department, don't hesitate to call.
If you have more questions for Chief Banker or the JFD, they would be happy to hear from you. Their contact information is listed on your screen, and you can always find it on our website. Thank you, Chief Banker, very much for your time today and allowing our viewers to get information about the Janesville Fire Department. And thank you, viewers at home, for tuning in. Don't miss next month's episode of Park Place Views, where we'll be talking to Shelly Slapak from the Recreation Division about upcoming spring and summer programs. In addition to tuning into this program on a monthly basis, you can stay connected to the city by following us on Facebook or Twitter, signing up to receive emails with our press releases and other important information, and subscribing to get alerts from the Janesville Police Department on Nixle. For Park Place Views and the City of Janesville, Wisconsin's Park Place, I'm Rachel Nabors. I'll see you next month.